Before we tell the story, let's stop and take it all in. The tall grass prairie in May. An endless quivering sea yielding to itself as new life takes over. Surrounded by land that's bridled by industry, the Neil Smith Refuge is a snapshot of our history, one that we are finding more and more reasons to reference today. This is land that doesn't flood, cut by streams that are filtered clean by the native plants and the thick roots, which are unmolested by the plow.
I keep saying we're about 26 years into a 150-year project.
Deputy Wildlife Manager Cheryl Groom is the latest to be saddled with the ongoing task of returning these 8,600 acres to their roots.
Most of the seed was brought in from other remnants, little pockets of prairie at cemeteries or along railroads.
The prairie flora was soon followed by native fauna, from the smallest to the largest, all following natural cycles again.
We've had 8 calves already, and usually we'll have around 15 calves in the year.
It's a sight that brings Iowans in from all around.
If you go about 4:30 in the afternoon, quite often the buffalo are crossing the road.
It's just open and you see some stuff that you don't normally see, you know, in your backyard or whatever.
Right, like a 2,000-pound bison out your window. This is America's easternmost federal herd.
Bison do very well in Iowa. They grow very large here.
On the perimeter is Sparky, a large bull who was struck by lightning in 2013 and still bears the large scar.
He's still around. He's still doing pretty well. He's a little on the thin side, but he's a survivor.
One of the most unique parts of the Neil Smith Refuge is a part that most people don't know about. This 14-acre hillside. It's a prairie remnant, one of the few pieces of Iowa that has never gone under the plow. You can tell by some of the plants that you find here, like this, Golden Alexander. They are prairie species that could have never found their way here on their own.
It's just kind of a reminder of where we came from and what is out there in nature, and that we're part of this too.
That's exactly what legendary Congressman Neil Smith was thinking as he searched for land for the refuge in the 1980s. He got a call from Iowa Power and Light about a large plot originally reserved for a nuclear plant.
And he called me and said they just had a board meeting and decided to sell that land because they're not going to use it.
Smith quickly found the funds. A World War II hero, a 36-year member of Congress, an accomplished attorney, he calls this one of his crowning achievements.
I wanted a place that was like native Iowa. For school children, a place for them to go and see nature.
At 96, Smith still visits the refuge weekly and delights in the sight of children connecting with it.
They need to know that there's a balance of nature, and that nature is more powerful than anything else.
Each new season here is a reminder. Nature doesn't need faith or luck. It only needs a chance and a little space and some Iowans, young and old, to believe it deserves both. In Prairie City, Andy Fales, Channel 13 News. Images like these and say, this is Iowa. That makes for good rhetoric, but in fact, it's more accurate to say that this is. This sterile, quiet floor of the State Historical Building is where every thread in the rich embroidery of our past is documented and stored and about to be called on.
It's a very large job. I sometimes wish some days there were multiples of me.
Pity Tony Jan, Iowa's state archivist. The task he's got in front of him is staggering. Take every photo, newspaper, governmental record, and otherwise significant historical document in here, and digitize it.
We want to remove the barriers to information so people can more easily discover their past, learn from it, and do the things they want to do into the future.
In short, he wants to make all this stuff available for your next Google search.
Digitizing this, though, this becomes more useful.
It becomes very useful, again, because we would do it in a way where the words can be indexed and they're searchable.
So you could search for horse pills and find this.
This horse and the rider.
From 1841, inside Iowa's oldest remaining newspaper.
So this is the Tamus settlement.
Or search for some of the very first Iowans and not only find the Meskwakis, but identify each man in the photo.
That might be the only photograph that may exist to some of these people.
Grants from the Library of Congress have Jan and his crew off and running on photos and death certificates. But with this job,
just project after project after project.
Call this the 10,000 pound gorilla.
The largest single collection of newspaper on microfilm, and certainly in the state.
There are 55,000 rolls of microfilm in here, holding virtually every newspaper published in Iowa ever. Many with stories that deserve another telling.
Der Carroll Democrat.
Der Carroll Democrat. That's a great font.
Iowa once had many papers printed in German, but then came World War I and William Harding.
The governor at the time, he issued something called the Babel Proclamation. In that fervor, they banned German language, and it was a direct assault on German culture.
Only here is that history still alive. Digitization will give it new life and let it be there to remind us all of these lessons we learned the hard way.
And when the next group of people come in from some other part of the world or other part of the country that we would never expect today, we can be comforted by the fact that it's not the first time it's happened, it won't be the last, and let's learn from those lessons and let's be better for it as Iowans.
The material is all here. But for now, it takes this. And we want this. With a little more time, money, and Tony Jan, we'll have it. In Des Moines, Andy Fales, Channel 13 News. If it's not the most famous corner in Sheraton, it is the most ironic. Piper's Grocery, where no one is calling for change.
We're a business that gets told frequently, we hope you never, you know, never go away.
But within the store that seems to have stopped the clock, there's a room in back that's working to beat it.
Christmas has just gone kind of crazy on us.
That's partly because we've gone crazy for Piper's.
I've had waited on the mother who said, my son called and said, Mom, you forgot to send my candy.
So there are up to 9 women working all day.
16 years I've done this.
Every day.
I can't smell it anymore.
What a pity. In copper kettles in use since the Truman administration, it's made from scratch.
Double dip toffee.
Caramel rolls, fudge, and the turtles. Ooh.
Pinching them. That's one of the first things you learn to do when you come to work at Piper.
Pecans come from the same Georgia farm every year.
Oh, when I call up, they'll be like, well, hello, Miss Jill. What can I help you with?
Just more pecans. The rest is up to these ladies. They'll fill 1,000 boxes.
I enjoy working with my hands.
That's good because aside from the occasional spoon, hands are the only tools you'll find. Knowing hands, wise ones. They'll do every part.
Yeah, they're very popular actually.
From the initial order through the assembly. And then wrap not once, but twice before boxing it all up to ship.
If you messed with that, you'd be in trouble.
Since taking over for Bob Piper in the 80s, Ann Kearns has stayed open by staying true.
There's a tremendous amount of tradition.
It's there from the walls to the floor and extends to her daughter.
That's the next step in making a turtle.
now in charge.
I'm very happy that Jill took the store. That was a real pleasure for me.
The phones are still rotary, but the website is humming. So you can bet Piper's will continue to make it.
We get just a little bigger every year and a little few more orders, and we think we just can't possibly do this, but we do.
And that's good to know. On the favorite corner in Sheraton, something is still working.
And it's darn good.
As good as ever. Andy Fales, Channel 13 News. Wow, it is a long drive to Denver, Missouri. But that's where you have to go to find Bill Engel in his glory.
Yes, yes.
He's got a captive audience today.
And you would take the box off of a traditional farm wagon and put it on here, do you see?
They're a church group from Kearney, Missouri, and they're impressed.
These slaves are fascinating.
If you got mud, you got mud.
Bill not only looks like Santa, he's also into sleighs.
And the third characteristic is how heavy they are. I mean, they're a horse killer.
No one has more than he does.
I've never seen this many in this condition.
Nearly 300.
So you see, they're about 3 inches taller.
Engel started collecting 16 years ago when he saw an old sleigh purchased at an auction, then immediately torn apart.
I said, what are you doing? And they said, all we want is the runners. I says, what for? And they says, we're going to cut them down a little bit and make coffee tables.
He was offended and started buying all he could find, many from Iowa.
So I don't redo the sleighs. I try to stabilize them.
And this is about all they're used for. A history class.
You see that? You put your mother-in-law back here.
This group never got such a lesson.
I grew up in Louisiana. We didn't have much need for a sleigh down there.
We learned there were more than 5,000 sleigh manufacturers in America at the turn of the 20th century.
And the sides here are the bumpers.
The Kratzer Carriage Company of Des Moines made this one. This is a Studebaker. This, a John Deere. This is one part collection, one part shelter.
I've inherited sleighs from people I didn't even know. And they would call and they would say, I'm getting old and I want somebody to have my sleigh.
He gives regular tours and takes regular phone calls from sleigh owners who need advice.
They tell me they went to Walmart and Walmart said, get this good latex and this will take care of it.
Don't paint an old sleigh. Just clean it off and call Bill.
And I'll be glad to help them any way I can.
But now it's Bill who needs some help.
You know what I'm talking about, don't you?
He's 77 and recently lost his wife. He needs a plan.
I have sold some to museums to try to save them. And it's got windmills on it painted.
He'd like to place them all in museums. He won't sell to pickers.
I've repeatedly had people come down and wanted to buy this one and offer me a big check. And I just had to tell them no.
So all he can do is keep sharing his love.
Isn't that interesting?
Maybe he'll connect with the right person, and the next great sleigh collector will make the long, long drive to Denver. Andy Fales, Channel 13 News.